Friends, our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Hear these words greeting you and welcoming you to this place. Grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits that are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Amen. We have gathered together this morning to praise God, to witness to our faith, and to give thanks for the life of Stan Haan. We come together in sadness, acknowledging our loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. Dying, Christ destroyed our death. Rising, Christ restores our life. In baptism, so many years ago, Stan was sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked as Christ's own forever. Let us pray together. God, our comforter, you are our refuge and strength, a helper close at hand in times of distress. You forgive what we have done and what we have left undone. Your mercy is from everlasting to everlasting. Help us so to hear the words of our faith that our fear is dispelled, our loneliness eased, and our hope reawakened. May your Holy Spirit lift us above our natural sorrow to the peace and light of your constant love, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I'd like to share several scripture passages that were meaningful to Stan with you this morning. The first is from Psalm 34, verses 1 through 14. The psalmist writes, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. Look to him and be radiant, so your faces shall never be ashamed. This poor soul cried and was heard by the Lord and was saved from every trouble. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his holy ones, for those who fear him have no want. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Which of you desires life and covets many days to enjoy good? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. And these words from John's Gospel, John chapter 6, verses 35 through 40. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But I said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. Everything that the Father gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. This is indeed the will of my Father, that all who see the Son and believe in him may have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. And these words from Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 11. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And to deal with sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, so that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh. You are in the Spirit. Once the Spirit of God dwells in you, anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to Him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through His Spirit that dwells in you. And there were two hymns that Stan longed to be played at his funeral. The first is "Great is Thy Faithfulness." And this is a recording by Maranatha Music. Listen to these words. Words from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Always, everyone, everything, all. If there's anything the Apostle Paul wants the Philippian Christians to know, it's this. The good news of Jesus Christ is an all-encompassing, all-embracing, all-inclusive reality. Rejoice in the Lord always. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. In everything, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Whether he's writing about time or people or things or knowledge, Paul wants the Philippian Christians of the first century and the Orange City Christians of the 21st century to know that this whole following Jesus enterprise is a comprehensive, inclusive, all-engaging, wide-ranging endeavor. To quote the great Dutch theologian Abraham Kuyper, there is not one square inch over all of creation of which Christ does not exclaim, mine. Now, I don't know about you, but I find it a bit troubling that the Apostle Paul begins with joy and seems to insist that joy is to be the foundational character trait or disposition of all Christ followers at all times. Rejoice in the Lord always. I admit that I squint to search for a footnote or an endnote, hoping for an exemption or an exclusion. Paul says, rejoice always, and I want rejoice except for, or rejoice but for. Not only that, Paul doubles down, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. It seems like an odd text, given our context today. We've come to grieve, to mourn, to say goodbye to a dearly beloved spouse of some 66 years, a committed and proud parent, a doting and loving grandparent, a kind and generous friend. Rejoice? Rejoice always, Paul? Are you sure about this? It's helpful to remember, of course, that Paul pens these words, not from some ivory tower of power and prestige, but from prison. Paul's faced suffering and persecution. He's known agony and pain. He knows that to follow Christ necessitates the carrying of a cross. And still he insists, rejoice always. And just why does he insist on this? Because he centers our joy not in the cultural trappings of pain-free pleasure and euphoric happiness, but in a person through a salvation. Rejoice in the Lord, always. Paul's comprehensive command centers us in something beyond ourselves, beyond our circumstances, beyond the emotional roller coaster of euphoric highs and depressive lows. Paul centers our joy in Christ, which means joy is so much more than happiness. Happiness is circumstantial. Joy is foundational. Happiness is something we buy and consume. Joy is something given to us and something that we are called to give away to the world. For Paul, who pens these words from prison, joy is found in Christ. Always rejoice in the Lord. Always. Everyone, let your gentleness be known to everyone, for the Lord is near. If joy is the all-consuming, cascading condition of Christian character, then gentleness is the gift that arises from that joy to be shared with the world. The Greek word for gentleness connotes generosity, a spirit of kindness that gives and shares and sacrifices. And note, it is indeed a gift for the world. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. Again, we may look for an except for or a but for, but search and scour the tiny black words on the paper-thin pages of our Bibles all we want, we simply won't find one. There are no exclusions, no exemptions, no exceptions. And note that like our joy, our gentleness is linked to Christ. Let your gentleness be known to everyone, for the Lord is near. In Jesus Christ, the kingdom has come already. It's here, but not yet, not fully, not entirely. We're awaiting the day of his return, the day when he'll establish his eternal reign of mercy and justice and love and peace and joy. So for followers of Jesus, gentleness is to be our modus operandi, the way Christ does his work in the world, in us and through us, until he returns and establishes his gentle and generous kingdom. Everyone. Let your gentleness be known to everyone, for the Lord is near. Everything. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. In everything, let your requests be made known to God. If joy is the all-consuming condition of Christian character, and gentleness is the gift that arises from that joy to be shared with all the world, then prayer is the all-encompassing conduit of conversation. Followers of Jesus are called into conversational covenant with the King. Self-talk transformed to God talk. There are no limits to the conversation, whether we're anxious or alone or afraid or calm or connected or courageous. It makes no difference. All are conducive to prayer, and all prayer is connected to a King. In everything, let your requests be made known to God. In the person of Jesus, we're called out of our narcissistic navel gazing to look up and to look out, to call up and to cry out to a God who promises by the power of the Holy Spirit to hear us, to heed us, to answer us with assurances of his merciful presence and grace. Everything, in everything, let your requests be made known to God. And all. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. If joy is the all-consuming character trait of Christ followers, gentleness, the gift that arises from that joy to be shared with all the world, and prayer is the all-encompassing conversational conduit to connect us with the King, then God's peace, revealed in Jesus Christ, is the all-surpassing guardian of our hearts and minds. I find it fascinating that what guards our minds, the peace of God, also surpasses our minds. Our world defines peace as the absence of war. But in God's kingdom, peace is shalom, or wholeness, or well-being for all. Peace is a harmonious world, a world where all are on the same team. Can you imagine it? Where all are working the same direction. Can you conceive of it? Where all are focused on the same goal. Christ, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. Our world has gone so radically awry, it's hard for us to imagine, let alone conceive of this kind of peace, this kind of shalom, this kind of wholeness and well-being for all. All, the peace of God which surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Rejoice always, gentleness to everyone, prayer in everything, peace which surpasses all understanding. Indeed, Paul is crystal clear. This following Jesus business is not for those who like things divided and divvied up, for those who live piecemeal and parceled out lives. Following Jesus is a comprehensive call, all the time, all the people, all the circumstances, and it results in a peace that is beyond all understanding. Stan de Haan knew this because Stan de Haan lived this. Phyllis, Jeff, and Cindy, it was such a delight for Elizabeth and I to sit with you on Wednesday at the funeral home and to hear stories of Stan's life and witness, his impact on your own lives and the many ways you saw the impact, his life impact, the larger life of this community. You told stories of family memories, Twins games and the Twin Cities, followed by swimming to cool off after. You spoke of his love for games and for his willingness to play Monopoly with the grandchildren when those grandchildren's parents may not have had the patience to do so. A side note, I think Stan secretly loved this so much so that he could teach his grandkids about the finer ins and outs of all things money and treasury related. You spoke of his nature, a farm boy at heart. He always loved gardening, big gardens with lots of tomatoes and, as a result, lots of tomato juice. You spoke of his love for sports, for all things MOC, Floyd Valley Dutch, and Northwestern College Red Raider, and Iowa Hawkeye, and Dallas Cowboy. Note, this did not include all things Unity Christian, but God, in God's good humor, decided to play a little joke on Stan in granting Stan's only daughter, Cindy, the gift of a spouse who was indeed a graduate of Unity Christian. Early in life, Stan encountered an accident with one of his eyes, which was replaced with a glass eye, and I thought it telling that Jeff was the one who said, "You always had to be prepared for the one-eyed stare." I took this to mean that the one-eyed stare served as a way to express parental disappointment or to encourage better behavior. And then there's Phyllis. 66 years of marriage. Phil, how incredible. Stan loved you dearly, evidenced by the fact that nearly any time I encountered him, I always encountered you. He cared so deeply for you. He loved you. As a pastor, these are some of my most favorite moments in ministry. Don't misunderstand me. Death is deeply painful, and Elizabeth and I are deeply grieved today. But to listen to family members share these stories, these sacred and holy and humorous stories, is such a gift. In fact, when Elizabeth and I were walking out of the funeral home, we told Chad Ullman we were finished, and referencing the boisterous laughter, Chad smiled and said, "Sounded like you all were a little rowdy in there." But as a pastor, my job this morning is to name God. Specifically, my job is to name God in the life of Stan DeHaan, and I can think of no better way to do so than to reference Paul's words from Philippians 4:4-7. First and foremost, joy. If you ever met Stan DeHaan, you met an exceedingly joyful person. He flashed his smile early and often, but unlike the glad-handing smiles we see from so many of our celebrities and superstars, Stan's smile was authentic and genuine. He loved to smile. It came by him naturally. He loved to laugh. Cindy, I think you said it so well. Dad's smile would light up a room, and you're absolutely right. He did. He loved life, and it showed. And over the course of the past several months in our pastor to parishioner phone calls, he'd often say to me, "I've had a good life, Mike." His joy was deep in his bones. And we are all the better because he didn't keep it there. He let it spring up constantly and continuously. Second, gentleness. I mentioned earlier that the Greek word for gentleness in Philippians 4 is connected to the Greek word for generosity. And Stan was incredibly gentle and equally generous. His generosity of spirit was evident in every conversation I had with him, even when he didn't agree with me on something. I distinctly remember conversations with Stan about the Flourish building renovation project and his disappointment that the back wall of windows was going to be removed, separating the sanctuary from the old narthex. He disagreed and he let me know, but he did so kindly, gently, generously. He was a good statesman and churchman. He understood that disagreements were bound to happen and that even though we disagreed, we would continue. Don't miss this. We would continue to be connected to one another, to support one another, to love one another. Oh, how our town will miss his witness. I'm guessing much of this came to him through his service in the Sioux County Treasurer's Office and on the Orange City City Council and in the American Reformed Church Consistory and with the Sioux County Board of Supervisors and with the Orange City Chamber of Commerce, all of which is to say, he was also gentle and generous with his time, willingly giving of himself to serve in all sorts of capacities to make these places better. He truly loved Orange City and was honored to have served as an ambassador for his church, his community, and his country. And true to Philippians 4 fashion, Stan was gentle and generous to all and with all. He was the kind of person that would help a family who couldn't afford to pay for a funeral luncheon. For a family thrust into the throes of grief at a most inopportune time, his gift was gentle and kind. He was also exceedingly gentle with so many young people at American Reformed Church. As Elizabeth and I shared the news of Stan's passing this week, our own daughters were shocked and saddened. And I know of several young families, little boys and girls, who will deeply miss seeing Mr. Stan when in-person worship resumes in this place. He touched so many people with his gentleness. But I also want to talk about prayer and peace, specifically in these last few months while Stan underwent his journey with cancer. Due to the pandemic, all pastoral care is being conducted by computer, telephone, email, or U.S. mail. Visits that normally would be done in person, looking a person in the eyes, shaking a hand, touching a shoulder, all of that has been given up for a less connected reality of telephone calls or Zoom meetings or email messages or cards. I cannot state strongly enough just how much I dislike giving up in-person pastoral care, but in an effort to love our congregation and our community, it is what it is. And because God sufficiently provides, it has been enough. Stan and I chatted at least once a week throughout his journey with cancer. He'd update me on his appointments, his treatments, and his prognosis. And right away, the information seemed nebulous and vague to me. Doctors were trying to get a handle on things, trying to determine what to do, when to do it, how to do it. And yet, without telling me directly, I could tell that the prognosis was not good. There were little hopeful signs here and there, but for the most part, our conversations were pretty much the same. "Stan," I would say, "how are you doing?" "Oh, I'm doing quite well." "It's good to hear, Stan. How are you feeling?" "Well, not the best." "How's your appetite?" "Well, that's not that great either." "Are they hopeful about any other forms of treatment?" "Well, not really." Phil and I joked about this at the hospital this week when Stan was in hospice care and nearing the end of his life, about to enter into the life to come. For a guy who was dying of terminal cancer, it was pretty remarkable that he always seemed to be doing so good. At the end of every conversation, I would ask Stan if I could pray with him, and he always was so eager for those prayers. "Yes, please. Hold on a second. I need to put you on speakerphone so that Phil can hear too." He was so kind and generous in his words of appreciation for a pastor whose prayers at times must have felt like they were evaporating into thin air. And I've been reflecting on this a bit. I mean, how is it that Stan was able to stay so optimistic? Let me say it better. How is it that Stan was able to stay so hopeful? See, there's a difference, isn't there, between optimism and hope? Stan knew that there wasn't much optimism necessarily for his healing, but hope? That was truckloads of hope, giant amounts of hope. And how do we know this? Because of his scripture bouquet. Now, I know you're probably curious as to what I mean by scripture bouquet. Well, on Wednesday, when we met with the family, we asked them for specific scriptures that were meaningful for Stan. Phil smiled widely and said, "Well, he's got a whole bunch." And she handed us this sheet and these little sheets of paper on which he had written all kinds of passages that were meaningful to him. Elizabeth said, "Oh, that's beautiful. It looks like a bouquet of flowers." Indeed, I love that image. It does indeed look like a bouquet of flowers. And so it's no wonder Stan exuded joy and expressed gentleness. His life was grounded in a good and gracious God who, out of God's great love, sent Jesus Christ to live and die, to be raised from the dead, to ascend to heaven, and to grant us the gift of the Holy Spirit, who unites us to Jesus even in this day, even in our grief. One day Jesus will indeed return at the final resurrection, and the dead in Christ will be raised to new life in the new heaven and the new earth. Stan knew this, evidenced by the 23 scripture passages he included as possibilities for his funeral service. Being gracious to his pastor, he said, "Take your pick." It's no wonder all-encompassing joy, all-encircling gentleness, all-inclusive prayer, and all-subsuming peace were the hallmarks of his life. His life was shaped by Jesus, the one who lived and died and was raised from death and promises to one day return and raise us too. So thanks be to God for the life and witness of Stanley Lloyd DeHaan. Thanks be to God for his smile and laughter, for his good-natured ribbing and gentle concern, for his generosity of spirit and generosity of resources, and for the one at the center of it all, Jesus, the Christ, the one who in everything draws us close in prayer and upholds us with a peace that surpasses all understanding. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray. For all the saints, O God, who from their labors rest, who thee by faith before the world confessed, thy name, O Jesus, be forever blessed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thou wast their rock, their fortress, and their might. Thou, Lord, their captain in the well-fought fight. Thou in the darkness drear their one true light. Alleluia, alleluia. O blessed communion, fellowship divine, we feebly struggle, they in glory shine. Yet all are one in thee, for all are thine. Alleluia, alleluia. O may thy soldiers, faithful, true, and bold, fight as the saints who nobly fought of old, and win with them the victor's crown of gold. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But lo, there breaks a yet more glorious day. The saints triumphant rise in bright array. The King of glory passes on his way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. From earth's wide bounds, from ocean's farthest coast, through gates of pearl, streams in the countless host, singing to Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Alleluia. Alleluia. Amen. We now get to hear those wonderful words of our Christian faith through the words of Amazing Grace, as sung by one of Stan's favorites, Tennessee Ernie Ford. Following the song, Bev Rohrs will come forward and offer a family remembrance on behalf of the family. Let's listen together.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. Was blind, but not
When the Lord calls our loved one home and will leave a gift of memories in exchange, our hearts are empty now, but hurt filled the happy moments. Stan went through life working hard to support his family. He adored his kids, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, and taught them how to love one another. He was such an ordinary man, but yet so special to so many. He was truly a fatherhead figure to our family. He was always there to lend a hand when necessary. We were all shocked how fast his disease progressed, and we know time will soften the edges and ease our burdens. It takes a little darkness for us to see the stars and a whole lifetime to reach them. He was so content with a simple life. He instilled values and Christian morals. We needed to celebrate his life in a special way. Remember how short life is and treasure the memories as they carry through the sorrowful times. Whatever part you played in his life, we thank you for being his friend. God is always in our corner, an ear to listen, a hand to hold, and a heart to share. Stan was a man, a husband, a brother, a father, a grandfather, a neighbor, but most of all, a Christian friend to so many. Some roads are rough to travel, and through dusty trails we've run. We've watched as dark clouds covered skies, abandoned by the sun. For he has made all beautiful, his gift is in each day. The worth is ours for spending here. Look up, he'll show the way. We have a treasure in our lives worth more than any gold. With arms outstretched, he gives his hands for each of us to hold. We will truly miss you, Stan. They would like to invite everyone to Nederlanders for lunch after the ceremony.
Thank you, Bev, for sharing that wonderful tribute. Let's pray together. O God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your servants who, having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. Especially we thank you for your servant Stan Haan. We praise you for the gift of his life, for all in him that was good and kind and faithful. We thank you for the grace you gave him that kindled in him a love for you and enabled him to serve you faithfully. We thank you that for Stan, death is past and pain ended, and that he has now entered the joy you have prepared for him. Give us faith to look beyond touch and sight, and seeing that we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, enable us to run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Stanley Lloyd Haan. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. We pray this in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'd like to ask the congregation to please rise. Now may the God of peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good so that you may do his will, working among us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you now and always. Amen.